Thank you. I know you were suggesting an encore, but they're trying to hold the service today to 3 days. Everybody here knows that mic and music are synonymous. Mike Spates played 1,001 songs, but the one you just heard, Twilight Time, was considered his signature song, and he played it everywhere he went. Now, on behalf of Judy, Mike, David, Janice, and the entire Marotta family, it's a pleasure to welcome you here today and to thank you for being here for this service in memory of Michael Marotta Sr. Now, I'm sure there's going to be a few tears here today. There always are, it seems like. But this is not a day of mourning. This is a day of celebration. It's a celebration of the beginning, the middle, and the ending of the musical score of a great man, a father, and a grandfather. Now, this is a Christian service, and I know, looking out, many of my friends come from different backgrounds and traditions. That's perfectly fine. But I do think it would be helpful if I just briefly say there are reasons for a Christian memorial service. Let me quickly give them to you. There are three. Number one, it's an opportunity for all of us, by our very presence, to express the love and the respect that we had for Mike Marotta. Secondly, it's an opportunity to offer comfort and support to the members of Mike's family with our words and with our prayers. And thirdly, and most significantly, this is an opportunity to joyfully express our Christian hope and to emphatically declare, this is not the end of it all. Listen to these words of our Lord. I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. For whosoever believes in me shall never die. Let us look to God in prayer. Eternal God and our Heavenly Father, we look to you as the creator of all things. Everything we are and everything we have comes from you. I thank you today for Mike Marotta, and I thank you for all that Mike gave to us during almost a century here on earth. Today, I ask again for the family members that they might know your grace and feel your comfort and peace. And may they remember these words from the Hebrew psalmist, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in the time of trouble. And then help us all to remember, this life is not all there is. Help us to live, therefore, with our eyes fixed upon you and eternal values fixed within our hearts. For you have promised, those who put their trust in you will inherit eternal life. This we pray through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, I've been asked by the family to share a few personal words, not as a minister, but as Mike's friend of almost 50 years. Now, I'm sure that everybody here must have known Mike was Italian, very proud Italian. I guess you knew. In fact, he was a Sicilian. I also assume that most of you probably believe, therefore, that Mike must have been a Catholic. So what are we doing here? Mike's father was a Catholic. His wife, Phyllis, was a very devout Catholic. Mike was not a Catholic. Mike wasn't anything. Our friendship began, I guess, 49 years ago in Kiwanis Club. Our friendship deepened a bit 47 years ago when this church was just getting started in Monterey. Mike was on the planning commission and I needed help. But we really became close about 30 years ago. I got a call from Jim Russo. He said that he had a physical problem. Mike's cousin, Manny De Maria, was dying. Norm Chetlin had a physical problem. And he asked if I could meet with him and maybe give him a few words of encouragement. So Mike, Jim, Manny, Norm, and I met for lunch. We've continued to do so for 30 years, every Thursday. It began with just the five of us. There's been scores that have come and gone. It was 23 years ago that we had a memorial service right here in this building for Phyllis Marotta. Now, during all of these years, Mike and I had lots of spiritual discussions, as you can imagine. Not about his relationship with the church, but about his relationship with God. As a result, Mike would occasionally attend church here. He provided music for us here on many special occasions. One unforgettable occasion, there was nothing here but a slab floor and four concrete pillars, and Mike got a musical group together and came out, provided all the music for our morning service. His granddaughters, Christy and Rachel, became a part of our youth program and music programs here. During all of those years, Mike professed no faith. But that is not the end of the story. And unless Al Adolf and a few others take too much time, I will tell you the rest of the story in my closing remarks.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm here representing the Paisanos, something that was near and dear to Mike Marotta Sr. In fact, I'd like to ask all the Paisanos who are here today if you'd just stand for a moment. The motto for the Paisanos is the best part of a man's life consists of his friendships. And there's no doubt that all of us who were just standing are a testament to what Mike and a few others did 63 years ago. Buck Russo, Ted DeRyan, Bing Crosby, Phil Harris. Bing Crosby brought a golf tournament to the peninsula, and Bing Crosby came with Ted DeRyan and said to Buck Russo, you know, we'd like to have a party for all our friends who come up here. So, of course, what's the center of our party? The music. And Mike Marotta Sr. brought that music and made that music a bond for all Paisanos throughout all these years of Paisanos. Mike was the pops of Paisanos. He was the musician, the accordion man, the entertainer with that trademark smile, that jolliness about him. And anywhere you would go, Mike was always ready to greet you and ask you how you were. Mike, to all those who knew him, was friendly. He was a storyteller par excellence. He could just keep you there. Even though you knew the punchline of the story, you'd listen for 5 minutes just to hear him tell the story. He was a man of his family. You see and you know, and you'll see more of the family through this service today. But Mike was the man who was the glue over all these years for Paisano. And we can assure you as Paisanos that we will continue to share friendship in his memory for as long as we go on. And we will tell our sons about Mike Marotta Sr. so that they carry on that same love of friendship. And I can tell you something that the Paisanos who are here are all familiar with. St. Peter is up there at the gate, and I know he's putting a moratorium on all musicians because he said to all the musicians, we've got an accordion player coming, and he's going to do the tarantella, and you better be ready for it. God bless Mike Marotta Sr.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Well, that was just a little sympathy thing in case I blow this whole deal. At any rate, a little bit of Glenlovet scotch and a whole lot of Marotta was the way we used to do celebrations for darn near a half a century. However, I don't think that's exactly what my pastor, Wayne Adams, has in mind for us this afternoon. So I'm just going to recite. I'm going to recite a paraphrase. Paraphrase of a lyric of a love song. Actually, a breaking up kind of love song. So where do you start? How do you separate the present from the past? And how do you deal with all those things that didn't last, you hoped would last? With bits of memory scattered here and there, I look around, I just don't know where to start. Which stories were Mike's? Which jokes were Mike's? And which were mine? You see, our lives were somewhat tangled, like the branches of a vine that intertwine. So many times we had, trips we took, the stories could fill the pages of a book. One day, there will be a tune from an accordion again. I'll turn around, but Mike won't be there, not then. You see, it was just a moment that used to be. So where do you start? Do you allow yourself a little time to cry? Or do you simply close your eyes and kiss it all goodbye? I guess you can try. But for me, I don't know where, and I don't know when I would ever find a friend like Mike again. But I know that there will always be a place deep inside of me, a place within my heart that will always remember and love Mike Marotta. Shalom, Mike.
I was gonna wing it. But I felt I should write it down because I wanted every word to count. And also, Art told me I gotta keep it to 30 minutes. So instead of talking about Mike, I'd like to talk about what Mike left behind. Mike left behind a daughter. A daughter who did him right by loving him unconditionally. She has distinguished herself in the industry for which she has great passion, music. She established herself as the area's premier vocal teacher and a distinguished musician. Janice is also truly a great mother and a loving wife and a devoted and dedicated daughter. He left behind a son, a mentor to me, who left town and went out and found the world, but never lost sight of the importance of family. A son who made his mark in a huge way in the music industry. A son who, like his other siblings, raised a beautiful family. Dave once told me, as I was complaining about not having a family structure like his and not having a patriarch dad like his, why don't you just become the patriarch? And now, because of Paula, I'm allowed to do that with my grandchildren. He left behind a daughter who was compelled to always be there for him, who's a pillar of our community. Partly because of the character traits her dad instilled in her. A daughter who is of the utmost integrity, who graciously and without fanfare lowered rent across the board for tenants as the economy faltered. These are traits that Judy shares with her father. He left behind another patriarch who has, for as long as I've known him, been passionate about keeping the family unit together in many, many ways. Not the least of which is embracing the adoption of a grandson. A grandson who Mike Jr. holds as his own flesh and blood. And again, he has the highest integrity in business and community, as did his father. And as you all know, Art is a consummate musician as well. Pops left behind four kids. Four kids who are easy to love. And although each of us is going to be who we are no matter who raises us, the reality here is Mike had a lot to do with how this family turned out. He left behind friends and a community that adored him, a business community that benefited greatly from his accomplishments, and no one could ever say he didn't have integrity. The city of Monterey lost a champion. He left a music community that will never again have such a legacy as his. And Mike left behind a friend in me,
a friend in me because he gave me so much friendship and so much encouragement. He believed in me when I couldn't, and he wasn't the wisest man alive, yet he gave me more moments of wisdom than any other person in my life. And though he may have had his moments, he was as nice to me and as kind to me as anybody in my life, ever. He told me once that even though others, including his own son, may have hit the big time, he admired me for eking out a living in music. These words kept me going forward. And Pops was obviously a great hang. He left behind in me someone who misses just being with him. I simply enjoyed his company, as did Paula. So when the family tells me I was a good friend to him, it was a bit selfish on my part. Because most likely, whether he knew it or not, I got much more out of my relationship with him than he did from his relationship with me. And as I told Judy earlier, I cried the last 40 times I played Twilight Time with him. And today was no exception. He's laughing right now. Having said all that, I'm going to leave it to each of you to figure out just who this guy was for you. To me, he was just the real deal. And as Paula pointed out, just like on all these gigs, he left us all wanting more.
One of the many things that Pops taught his kids and his grandkids was how to recognize a great song. And this, it doesn't matter if it was an Italian opera aria or a song from a children's television show sung by Kermit the Frog. Magic. Have you few months ago, I went and visited Pops on a Sunday afternoon, and he was engrossed in a Charlie Chaplin film festival of some type, where Charlie Chaplin's theme song, Smile, was being played in the background. And we just sat there and watched this beautiful silent movie, and it dawned on me the reason why he loved Charlie Chaplin so much is because Charlie Chaplin was a clown, and so was my dad. And he related to him, and the reason that I say that is because in the entertainment business or in the entertainment world, you're primary purpose, your primary job is to help people forget about their troubles, whether it be during the Great Depression or in the war, entertaining wounded soldiers. That is your job, is to put your own feelings and your own sadness and your own hardships on the shelf and just give to those and help lift their spirits. And this was one of his favorite songs.
Though your heart is aching, smile, even though it's breaking. When there are clouds in the sky, you get up. If you smile through your fear and sorrow, smile.
Well, a lot has been written about our dad, especially in the last couple of weeks. I'd like to share a few things from the family's perspective. Our dad, he was known as Pops to us, and he was also known as Big Pops to the littlest grandkids. He had zero problem with self-esteem. He absolutely loved attention and good reactions that he could get when storytelling, playing music, and oftentimes even flirting. He was a big flirt. Sometimes he seemed bigger than life, and sometimes his ego seemed much bigger than his actual size. He had the best smile, the cutest wink for anybody that would be willing to listen to one of his stories. Over the years, the stories got longer and longer and bigger and better. And as long as he had a captured audience, we couldn't get him to stop. We, the family, would often just roll our eyes, and he'd catch us rolling our eyes, and he would look at us and he'd say, "What? I can't help it. I'm short, fat, and cute." Well, he was 5'2". He was small in height, but he was so big in heart, love, generosity, and most of all, laughter. He was a masterpiece in fun, enthusiasm, and inclusion of everyone. We cannot ever remember a single time that he was mad, stressed, or even a little bit upset. Over the years, he's been interviewed a lot, and Mike and I would sit in a different room while he was being interviewed, and we'd hear this question. "Mr. Marotta, we've heard you've done pretty well in life." And then he would answer, "Oh, yes, I'm a wealthy guy." Ay, ay, ay. Mike and I would be sitting in the next room going, "Oh, what's he gonna say next?" But he would define what he meant, and he would say, "Yes, I am a wealthy guy. I have something money cannot buy. I am so wealthy because I have a great family. I have the most fantastic business partners who feel like family, and I have more good friends than I could ever count." As I look out in this room, I would like to ask a favor. If there's anyone in this room that considers themselves a friend of Pop's, a business partner, a fellow musician who's ever played with him, or someone who has sat with him at the big round table at his beloved Pacheco Club, a member of the Paisano Club that he so loved, some of the fellows from his Thursday old friends lunch group that Pastor Adams talked about, or just anybody that he's ever invited to the house for a meal or a party. If any of you fit that description, I would like you to raise your hand. Okay, family, turn around. Turn around and look at all the hands that are raised. This is his confirmation of his belief that he really was a wealthy man. Our family would like to give special recognition to five gentlemen. They are the wonderful caregivers who made it possible for our family to have 7 years beyond what Pops was supposed to ever have. Because of these fine gentlemen, Pops was able to stay in his own house because of the great care they gave him. Our family got a very long, sweet goodbye with the very best last day of his life, not only for us, but for him. After a full day with an impromptu, very unplanned family dinner, we all wound up at his house at the same time. We spent most of the afternoon and the evening at his house, where he continued to regale us with the same stories we've heard over and over again. That day, he was fixated on old Monterey, old downtown, and old music from the 30s and 40s. He just could not stop talking about all those things that meant so much to him. Well, we left his house at 9 o'clock on Sunday. He was tired, went to bed, and he closed his eyes not 10 minutes after we departed. And he peacefully and calmly left this world for accordion heaven. A close family friend of Pop says that he has it on good authority that the first thing he did when he got to heaven was fire all the trumpet players and the harp players, and he replaced them with accordions. So getting back to the caregivers, Dale, who made this beautiful arrangement by himself of an accordion, we just found out. Dale, Oliver, Donald, Jing, and last, but certainly not least, Juan, where are you fellas? Can you please stand up? Juan has been with Pops for 7 years. He treated him as though he were his second father. Juan brought his wife and daughters over all the time. They became a part of our family, and they will always be. Juan, I don't know where you are, but you made it possible for Pops to attend 3 of his grandkids' weddings, and 2 of them were in Los Angeles. Juan, you took him out almost every day to either breakfast, lunch, or dinner, and often to meet some of his closest friends. Because of you, Juan, our dad felt alive, valued, and important all the way to the very last day. Our family cannot thank you enough. Okay, this is the hard one. There's one more person who has quietly, calmly, and professionally overseen Pop's care, not only with his caregivers at home, but also whenever he had to visit our hospital. With excellent medical skills and judgment, she is one of the most humble people we have ever known. She's a nurse practitioner who also is the assistant director of the emergency department at Community Hospital. She's also the firstborn grandchild of Pops. It's Christy Marotta. Where are you? Where are you? Christy always made sure that Pops was well taken care of. And the best thing she did was she kept the entire family on a text message chain so we could all know what was happening at all times. Pops was so impressed with Christy. He said her medical knowledge and the way she explained things to him made everything so simple. Just a few weeks ago, I walked into a hospital room and he was sitting up talking to the nurses. Christy was sitting on the couch doing her work for the hospital, but in his room, so she always knew what was going on. And he looks at me and he points at me really seriously and he says, I got to tell you something. You don't know what she did last night. I said, what'd she do, Pops? She remodeled the entire hospital, hired all new employees, and this is a 5-star place to hang out. That's Pops. To him, she did all that. On behalf of our whole family, Mike, Dave, our sister Janice, all the grandkids, all the super great grandkids, we feel so overwhelmed for the love and the stories you've shared with our family. You all loved our dad. He was a most remarkable, talented, generous, simply sensational father to all of us. He got to live nearly 10 decades of a very happy, vibrantly fun-filled life. The stories, the values, the love of our city, which he so loved, the love of family, and all of you great friends, will live on through the rest of our family because we were the beneficiaries of two of the finest parents ever. It seems that one good, short, little guy can touch more hearts than we would ever have imagined.
Over the years, I've been asked many times a real common question. What was it like to have Mike Marotta as your father? And you can put it into one sentence. Quite simply, I mean, it was incredible. We hit the parent lottery between my mom and my dad. But I'll have to disagree with Judy on one thing. Me and my brother managed to get my dad mad on quite a few occasions. The girls got away with murder. So I want to just kind of share a little bit about what it was like to have him as a dad. He was an incredible teacher, and he had ways of teaching that you didn't even know you were being taught. He gave us tools of life, tools of music, tools of business. And from a very early age, we were all required to play this thing. So at age 5, he puts one of these things in my lap. My brother was already playing The Flight of the Bumblebee. Judy was playing accordion. Everybody was doing great. He puts this in my lap. This thing has 120 bases here, 38 keys over here, and it weighs about 35 pounds. And I'm a little guy at 5 years old, and I hated this instrument. And he made us practice every day, 45 minutes. You can't go outside to play until you practice. So I hung with the accordion for a while, and then one night, we're watching the Ed Sullivan Show. And God smiled upon us and brought us the Beatles. And this is a revelation to all of us. And for me, it was a way out. The next day, I went to my father and I looked him straight in the eye and I said, Dad, there's too many accordion players in this house. I'm going to play guitar. I'm switching to guitar and I'm going to be a rock and roll musician. So he cocked his head. He looked at me and he paused and he said, rock and roll. I'll tell you what, we can do it my way. On Saturday mornings, you will come to the music store and you will take a classical guitar lesson every Saturday morning. But what he didn't tell me was that part of that deal was after the lesson, I had to clean toilets and polish guitars. But he gave me this guitar right off the rack. He had a lot of nice guitars. This is the guitar, 1967. It's a $49 Yamaha guitar, the cheapest guitar in the store. Apparently, he didn't think I was going to last very long. So my first lesson, I learned three chords. And that was incredible. I sounded better on my first lesson than 6 months of accordion. And so he kept on me. He says, you got to learn classical guitar. And after about a year, I was able to play some simple classical guitar pieces. And I played it much better then, but I still was not satisfied. This was not rock and roll. I wanted to play rock and roll. So I said to Dad, I said, I want to play rock and roll guitar. And he says, nope, you're not ready yet. On Wednesday nights, you're going to go to my friend Walter Kelsey, and you're going to learn music theory and harmony. And I had no idea what this was for. So I went, and I studied music theory and harmony. Meanwhile, my brother is playing baseball on Wednesday nights. Judy and Janice are taking dance lessons. Everybody's having fun but me. So finally, after a year of learning the nuts and bolts of music and him giving me the tools that I didn't even know he was giving me, he says, it's time for you to have an electric guitar. So I go down to the music store, and there's the Stratocasters over there and the Les Pauls that all the rock and roll guys were playing. And I had my eye on that, and he said, nope. This is your guitar. And I said, Dad, this is a jazz guitar. And he said, you're going to learn. You're going to come to the Del Monte Lodge on Friday nights. You're going to get a suit, and you're going to learn the American Songbook. I'm going to teach you these songs, and you're going to learn how to swing, because without swing, music doesn't matter. So I put on my suit every Friday night. He paid me $40. I'm 13 years old, and he said, by the way, 30 of that dollars goes in the bank every week. And so every week, I would just sit there and play with no amp. Not exactly rock and roll. So I continued with this, piled up some money, and then we had the Monterey Pop Festival. And during that weekend, we had incredible seats, and the bass players of all the great bands really spoke to me, and a light went on in my head that this was what I needed to do. So the next day, I went to my dad, looked him in the eye, and said, I'm quitting guitar, I'm going to be a bass player. And once again, he said, okay. You got to do it the right way. Go down to the store, pick out a bass. So I picked out this bass. And why did I pick this bass? Because this is a Rickenbacker, and the Beatles played Rickenbackers. And so, I don't know if it's on. So I really didn't know much about bass, but and there were no bass players, so Pops told me, he said, take all the years you played classical guitar, take that right-hand technique and apply it to the here. And now all of the music harmony and theory you have, you know what notes to play, you know what the notes are in the chords. Learn how to swing and start developing bass lines. And so literally on the second day, I was swinging. I knew what to do. And literally, I think it was that weekend, Art, correct me if I'm wrong, but your bass player had quit, Anthony Lucido, and you needed a bass player. And my brother had a unique thing going on. He was playing rock and roll, but he was also playing the American Songbook. He was playing standards. And I joined that band, which is now the Marotta band, for all these years, and we played the best gigs in town because we appealed to everybody, especially the older people that had all the money. And so, you know, I didn't even have a driver's license. My brother would drive me to the gigs. We'd play these gigs. We'd make great money. And that set me up for a career in music. And I left town, and I went to L.A., and I carved out somewhat of a career as a studio musician. And I can tell you, every time I picked up an instrument, I remembered right from where I came from, all the songs that I played with my brother and my father. And I remember one time my father came to a recording session. It was a big movie session. We were doing a movie score, and there was a 60-piece orchestra. I sat my dad next to me, put headphones on him. I said, "Be quiet. Don't talk." And my buddy Mark Levang was playing keyboard. My friend Carl Verheyen is here. He was playing guitar, and John Farrar was playing drums, and we had this fabulous 60-piece orchestra. And he sat all day, and he watched us score this movie with intense concentration. And we got in the car, and I looked at him. I said, "Dad, you look like you're exhausted." And he said, "I can't believe what you just did all day. This was like exhausting. How do you do it?" And I said, "Dad, I just used the tools that you gave me. It's easy." And so that, in a nutshell, was what kind of a teacher my father was. And fast forward to a couple of weeks ago, I had two incredible days with him before he passed. And I made sure I went and told him how much I appreciated everything he's done for us. And if there's any good that I've become, it was because of him. And he looked at me and he said, "I had nothing to do. I just gave you the tools. You went out and used the tools, and you did your thing. And for that, I'm proud of you." And I can tell you, I just aspire to be, if I can be half the man and father that he was, I will leave this world a happy man. Thank you for coming.
Remind me to never request being the last singer, last speaker again. I'll never do this again. Pops taught me a lot of lessons in life, and being in the music business, he said, always try to leave a gig with the audience wanting more. I'm going to be shorter than those guys. I know I speak for them all, siblings, family members, extended family members. You guys know who you are. The outpouring of love has just blown us away. I mean, the emails, people coming in our office, it's been Grand Central last week. We love it. Can't go anywhere without somebody giving us hugs. And the newspaper, the radio show, Dave's radio show, the Herald, the proclamation from the city of Monterey, from the mayor and city council. Thanks, mayor and city council, if you're out there. I bet you are. And the one that just blew us away completely was Congressman Jimmy Panetta. He did something on the floor of Congress that our family will treasure for generations and generations to go. I mean, my great-great-grandkids are going to watch that thing, and they're going to say, "Wow, Pops was a big shot." That was, Congressman, thank you. Thank you so much. My relationship with Pops was we were pals. He called me pal, and we did a bunch of stuff together, and a bunch of fun stuff. Some of my funnest times in life were with Pops, and I'm talking about just regular dinners, Paisano clubs, Campari clubs. I'm talking about going to Las Vegas. Pops loved Vegas. Did he love Vegas? And he loved to play craps. And I'm going to tell you, folks, we'd walk into a casino and. And it could be dead, and there could be no players. And Pops would grab me, maybe my brother, or whoever, Louis Cosentino's out there. He joined us. Anyway, a lot of people. And within 10 minutes, because Pops was being Pops, he just couldn't play craps. He had to be the Mr. Life of the party, Mr. One-liners, Mr. Jovial. All of a sudden, people are flocking to our table, and they're now line two and three deep. And I'm not exaggerating. This happened every single time. And I would walk away just shaking my head saying, if the pit boss had any brains, he'd hire this guy. This guy's good for business, man, you know. A couple other things that we've done recently were we've been going up and down California playing at accordion clubs, believe it or not. And that's a trip because when they first started asking us, my idea was I'd go over to my dad's and we're going to come up with four or five songs and we're going to have an arrangement and I'll play the first chorus, then you play the bridge, and then we'll do a harmony. And as I'm trying to explain my idea of these arrangements, I'm looking at him, I'm going, what am I doing right now? He's not going to pay attention to my arrangement. He's not going to follow it, and he's not going to even remember it. And if anybody's ever tried to cage a wild animal, That would be like me trying to cage a white llama. So I gave up. I gave up. We did these clubs, and we were always well received. And mostly because even though we winged it, Pops had the knack. Pops was an absolutely great, great musician from a standpoint of knowing the tempos to play, the feels for whether it's a bossa nova or a samba or a swing. He knew the right licks to play. And for any of you musicians out there that have played with him, you'll know what I'm talking about. You got to go with him. It's when you're playing with Pops, it's his gig, man. And you know what? You're happy to do so because it works. I'm gonna be quick here. A couple of funny things that I'm going to really miss. To all of his Jewish friends, of which there are very, very many, the greeting, "Hey Schmeckel," and his rendition of "Sam, You Made the Pants Too Long." I'll never get tired of that. Oh my God! When you're having dinner with Pops and it's time to leave, as the French would say, "Reservoir." These are things that my family rolls our eyes at, but if you're a newcomer, you think, oh my God, this guy's the funniest guy in the world, right? If you're having coffee at Plumes with the guys in the morning and somebody says, I gotta go to work, Pop stands up and says, nope, you get to go to work. Talking about how long he lived, last few years, he says, man, did I beat the system. And if you've ever seen him at the Italian Festival, if you've ever seen him at the Paisano Club or the Campari Club, what we need is less whoopee and more whoppy. I'm sorry, folks, but I'm going to miss these. So rather than tell you all how I feel about Pops, because I know you all know, I love my father so much, and all of us showed it every single day. He knew it. We knew it. No regrets from any of our family that he's passed on, because we showed him love and he showed us love. I want to just read a couple of things that are like recurring. I went through some sympathy cards and some recurring themes, and it's not going to take long. This is not me talking. This is you folks talking. A glorious life that we all should aspire to have. A legend who enriched the lives of all who knew him. I love this one. A masterpiece of attitude and enthusiasm. A treasure that filled our hearts with music, an amazing gift to our community and to our Italian heritage. And I call him my Monterey Pops. That's what he was to me. He was more fun to hang with than 95% of the people my age. So I'm going to close with a song, and I'm not singing it, so don't worry, folks. After my mom passed away, and at gatherings like Thanksgiving, Easter, and Christmas, Pops would recite an Irving Berlin song that was written in 1912. Irving Berlin, his wife died, and he was devastated. And he wrote, which could be one of the saddest songs I've ever listened to in my life. And Pops would recite it. And when he finished reciting this, it's only one verse, we would all be like crying. And then he would say, now I want to give you my version. Now, Rachel, I'm going to invite you up here to sing the song with me. I'm going to pick up the accordion, and Dave, if you can join us. I want you all to know, pay attention especially to the second verse, because the second verse is my father's verse. And my father would like me, I know him, to dedicate the second verse to all of you. Okay?
Thank you.
through this. as I met with the family talking about the service, and they talked about all the different speakers, the one thing they kept mentioning was, no, I don't want to follow so-and-so. I don't want to follow so-and-so. So finally they got to the end. I got to follow everybody. This is known as elder abuse. The good news is this. They set the time for the service, and I still have about 3 hours. So I'm very fortunate. Everybody knows Mike lived 98 years. You've heard some incredible stories from his family and from his friends. Now what? At the end of it all, is this life all there is? You live 98 years, it's over, that's it. Earlier in my remarks, I said about 30 years ago, I had countless spiritual discussions with Mike, and he professed no faith. And I also said that's not the end of the story. And right now, with your permission, or without your permission, I'd like to briefly share with you some of the end of the story. It was 10 years ago, I wrote Mike a letter. I was 80, he was 88. I wrote him a letter, and I'm going to share a little bit of that with you. It's much too long to share it all. I'll skip through it as fast as I can. But this is the way it began. My dear friend, for almost 40 years, I've considered you my dear friend, and I still do. You've brought enormous joy to my heart through your wisdom, music, humor, generosity, love, and a beautiful balance of both tenderness and strength. During our years of friendship, I've tried to be very clear about the importance of my faith to me, while at the same time, try not to force my beliefs upon you. We laughed countless times about my faith and your lack of interest in it. Well, I'm now 80 and you are 88, and I don't think that's a laughing matter anymore. During our chats, it has become apparent that we see things a bit differently. I believe this is our main difference. You believe in one world, I believe in two. You believe in a world you can see, I believe in a world we can see also. But I also believe in another world. You believe in a physical world, so do I. I also believe in a spiritual world that we cannot see. You believe we're nothing more than flesh and blood. When it's over, that's it. I believe you're flesh and blood, Mike. But you also have an eternal soul. So it seems to boil down to a matter of belief. And then what I did, and this is the lengthy part that I'll skip through. I said, I want to share with you, Mike, what I believe and why I believe it. And why it is so important to believe. And then I mentioned again to him, I said, Mike, I believe in a world we can see. Good grief, all you have to do is look at the mountains, the oceans, the sun, the moon, the stars, dogs and cats and elephants. It's a very real world. I believe in it. It's also a world of both good and evil, joy and misery. Then I said, I also believe in a world we cannot see. And I referred to it as a spiritual world. And like the world I can see, it produces both good and evil, joy and misery. I don't know how many times during luncheons we'd be discussing something, and all of a sudden Mike would say, as he said over and over again, "Why can't we all just get along?" And I said, "Mike, it's because of the world we can't see, the spiritual world, the Holocaust, this day, Pearl Harbor, the World Trade Centers, a lot of the other horrible things in the world are all the result of the influence of that world we cannot see, a spiritual world. Evil is the result of allowing the unseen force of a spiritual evil to produce these things, while believing in a spiritual force of good produces things that are special because that spiritual force is produced by a loving God that influences our behavior." Well, anyway, I had to rush through it. Then I said, "Mike, you need to know why I believe this. And this is very long, and I'll skip through it. There's a lot of reasons that I could give. The first thing I said was, I believe it because of our universe. Look around. Raise your eyes to the heavens. What do you see? You see a magnificent universe designed to perfection." I gave him a lot of other stuff, but I said, "Mike, look." He used to wear a Mickey Mouse watch. I said, "Do you think that Mickey Mouse watch was an accident, or did it have a designer? How about the Lexus he was driving? Did it have a designer? How about a B-47? They've all got a designer. But we look at the universe and say, it's magnificent, but it was just an accident." I don't think so. The psalmist declared, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament displays his handiwork." Oh, I'd like to say a lot more about that, but I can't. I then said, "Look at our bodies." And he liked to do that. Because, as we've already heard, he was short, fat, and cute. Where'd these bodies come from anyway? I really ought to have Christy up here now to tell us all this. But do you realize in our bodies there are 100 trillion cells? I don't know about you, but I'm impressed. Cells for everything. Nerve cells, bone cells, brain cells, etc., etc. All of these cells have to get along. And guess what? They do. How do they do that? Well, Christy would tell you. They have an instruction book. It's called our DNA. Do you realize how big that DNA is? If you took it and wrote out your DNA, it would fill 1,600 page books. Impressed? I was. And not only that, but that entire instruction book is in every one of the 100 trillion cells in our body. But of course, it was just an accident. The psalmist said, "You created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made." Well, after mentioning the universe and the body, I couldn't help but throw in a little scripture, and I said, "You know, I'm real impressed with prophecy. As we Christians believe, there are 300 prophecies that prophesied the birth of Christ. One scientist looked at them all, and he concluded that, look, let me just take 48 of them. And he took the 48 and said, "Do you know the odds of those 48 given hundreds of years before being fulfilled in the life of the birth of one person? It is 1 to 10 to the 157th power. You don't know what that is, and I don't either. It is 1 to 10 plus 157 zeros. Those are big odds. But it happened. And then I said, "What's so special about this one we call our Savior?" And I just gave one little paragraph here. There's been more done for education, medicine, music, art, women, the sacredness of human life, and the abolition of slavery because of this one life than anyone who has ever lived. And then, of course, I quickly tried to get to the end and say, now, what's the big deal here? Why is it so important that we believe? And very simple, it's because of what I said just a moment ago. He's gone. Nobody lives forever. Then what happens? Is life nothing more than 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 98 years? Is that it? Think about this. Someone has pointed out there are four levels of existence. Matter, that's things like rocks, glass, steel. Life, birds, cats, or excuse me, trees, grass, and flowers. Intelligence, dogs, cats, elephants. Spirit, man is the only one that possesses spirit. He is matter, but so is a rock. He is life, but so is a tree. He is intelligent, but so is a squirrel. But he is spirit, and no one else besides the human species possesses that. He has an eternal soul. In a nuclear explosion, matter, life, intelligence are vaporized. Even accordions. And the soul never dies. Everything we can see will pass away because it's all temporal. What we cannot see will never pass away. Well, I got to stop that and just wrap this up. I said that I wanted to finish with the end of the story. And that's what I'd like to give you now. The only thing is I can't find it. Maybe it's one of those. Retribution. All right. Now for the end of Mike's story. As I said, I wrote him this letter 10 years ago. Well, during the past 10 years, we never mentioned it, never discussed it. Judy tells me that he read it from time to time, that it's still in his desk drawer. But about 7 weeks ago, as many of you know, Mike went into the hospital. I went to see him every day. I didn't know if he'd live another day. And I was concerned. I was concerned that Mike find peace with the God he said did not exist. I didn't plan to do this, but I'll tell you a quick little story here. Mike came here to a Father's Day service once. At the end of the service, and I did this periodically, I just challenged all the fathers to come up here and let me pray for them because I wanted them to be good fathers. Everybody came. Mike has told this story 100 times, I don't know, at least. And he said, even Kent Mitchell came up. I don't know what that meant, Kent, but anyway, that's what he said. Mike sat about in the third row there. Everybody was gone. There stood Mike. Why go up there for crying out loud? I don't even believe in God. All of a sudden, Mike said, I felt a hand on my shoulder. He turned around. It was my wife, Pat, who died just a year ago. And she leaned down and said, Mike, I just want you to know Jesus loves you and so do I. Mike told that story again and again, and I told Judy, I said, my wife ought to be the one giving the service, not me. Well, what I decided to do at that point is to try to get to Mike musically. So I told him a couple of quick stories. Please bear with me as I try to rehearse these. The first one was written 280 years ago, a great oratorio. The composer had had a stroke. He could no longer conduct or perform. He was paralyzed in the right arm. He was nearly blind. He was deeply in debt and terribly distressed. But all of a sudden, he came across a little libretto, a book of scriptures, mainly from the Hebrew Bible. And he came across this libretto, and he decided to write an oratorio. And so, even though he was in that terrible physical and emotional condition, he devoted himself to writing a 259-page oratorio in 24 days. When he was finished, he says, "I think I have seen the heavens and God himself." And of course, we're going to sing it again soon. The Christmas Oratorio, The Messiah, by George Frederick Handel. Takes 2.5 to 3 hours to perform it fully. And it concludes with that magnificent hallelujah chorus. When I finished, I leaned over on the bed and I whispered to Mike, "Mike, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and he shall reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah." Mike's eyes were filled with tears. I felt impressed to tell him one short little story about another tune. I referred to a theologian, a German theologian he had never heard of, Karl Barth. Barth was considered one of the greatest theologians of the 20th century. He made a trip to the United States to speak at the University of Chicago. When he finished speaking, a reporter called out to him and said, "Dr. Barth, could you just give us your greatest insight into God in one sentence?" That's a big question. And what he did, and I told Mike, I said, "Mike," he answered with a children's song. This is such a musical place, I shouldn't dare. But it goes like this. "Jesus loves me, this I know." And before I could finish, Mike said, "For the Bible tells me so." I said, "Mike, you know God loves you, don't you?" And with tears in his eyes, he nodded his head and said, "Yes." I said, "Mike, how about you? Do you love him?" And Judy, he looked at me and said, "Yes." I don't know how many times Mike said to me jokingly, "Wayne, can you tell me why it is that in heaven they all play harps and in hell they all play accordions?" I reminded him of that, and I reached over and put my hand on his shoulder, and I said, "Mike, I don't know how many accordionists are going to hell, but I know one that isn't, and that's you." Now, why did I say that? In 2 minutes, I'll tell you. First of all, the Apostle Paul, the apostle to the Gentiles, in 2 Corinthians 5:1, wrote these words, "For we know that when this tent that we live in is taken down, that is this body in which we live until we die, we will then have not a tent, but a house in heaven, and an eternal body made for us by God himself and not by human hands." I'm sure many of you have heard of the children's books, 7 of them written by C.S. Lewis, The Chronicles of Narnia. Throughout those 7 books, Lewis talks about the life of these children and so on. And in the 7th book, in the last chapter, he wrote these words, "For us, This is the end of all stories. But for them, it is only the beginning of the real story. All of their life in this world had only been the cover page and the title page. Now at last, they were beginning chapter one of the great story, which no one on earth had ever read, and which goes on forever, and every chapter is better than the one before. Guess what? For us, this is the end of Mike's musical score. It's the end of his story. But for Mike, all this life was with the cover and title page. Now, he is beginning chapter one of the real story, which will go on forever, which no one has ever read. And every chapter of the story he's reading now will go on forever and is better than the one before. You heard what he said. A great score is a great beginning, great middle, and a great ending. But only Mike could say, we can mess up the middle, and we do. Mike did, and I did. I know we're ready to make him St. Marotta. He wasn't. Yes, yes, yes. He was short, fat, and cute, but not a Messiah. In the middle, he made some mistakes. But in the end, like the thief on the cross, he said, remember me, and I know God has. Let us pray. Eternal God, our words are so simple. Your truths are so great. Our lives are so brief. You are eternal. Once more, I thank you for this day, for all that has been said and heard, the music, the thoughts, the feelings expressed. Now we pray. Bless these, your people. Let them know they can go in your grace and in your peace. And as they do, may they go out in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and forevermore. Amen and amen. Vieni su, nene. Anche tu, per me. Ti farò vedere le stelle da vicino.